Good afternoon. For Hometown Cable, I'm Tom Brandell, and I'm here today with my father, Richard Brandell, and we've been asked to talk about the milk business. I think many people today would think nothing of going to the store and picking up a half gallon or a gallon of milk, but the purpose of this program really is to get back to, you know, what is the milk business about? What is a dairy? I think most people would understand the concept of a family farm. We have still many family farms around here, but many years ago there were many, many processing plants in Clinton County called dairies, and towards the end you could say there was a final three: Plattsburgh Dairy, Rosebud Creamery, and Bayview Dairy. And our family was fortunate enough to own and operate Bayview Dairy for over 50 years. And that processing plant would take milk from the local farmers and bring it to a plant. It was on Cumberland Head, and package the milk, basically. So we're here today to talk about that. And I guess, Dad, you were involved in the business starting right from the get-go, as soon as you can remember working. And can you tell us a little bit about the beginnings of Bayview Dairy on Cumberland Head?
Well, it started in 1929. My grandfather came from, he had been down in New York working on for Delwood Dairy or Sheffield, I'm not quite sure which dairy. And he got in an accident with a team of horses, got in an accident with a fanny farmer, truck, and he was crippled quite badly, and so he came back to Plattsburgh in I'd say 29 or 30, and he went over on the Moffett Road, and there was a farm there. It was putting up raw milk. His name was Leo Gay. In fact, I have a bottle of his, and he bought it out. And he ran that until 1932. And then my uncle, it would be my grandfather's son, and my mother's husband came back from New Rochelle, and they took over the business, bought it from him. And they continued on to the point of where well, we were probably in 1978, or my sister and I took over the business. They had passed away, one of my mother had, and my father passed away in 79. So we went from there, but back the first one was all raw milk when it first started. Now I called this lady, her father was a Gay. And I was told there were some milk caps out, and I called her to see if she had any, because I understand the first caps came out and said Gay Parker. So I'm not sure if that's a true fact, but she doesn't have any of the caps.
Okay. So basically, when you're talking about raw milk, and I think for the listeners and viewers to understand, raw milk, you mean milk that's what?
It's milk. It's came from the cow, and it was cooled, and then they bottled it. Okay. It was not pasteurized back then, and there was no homogenizing back then. We were going back in the 30s and back way back, and then there was the milk cans were put in the coolers back then, and they were used by packed with ice.
Well before the day of refrigeration. So we basically you have milk that's picked up from the farmer by somebody who owns a dairy and
a processing plant.
And how many, if we go back to let's say 1930 or 35, how many people were processing milk in Clinton County?
I believe there was 32 or 34. I'd have to look it up. But everybody had a little dairy back then, and they were processing milk. Fact that it used to have to put on your truck, said Plattsburgh Board of Health number, and they give you a number. And then back then, you could only go in certain areas. Like if you were, we could not go to Champlain. And we were only allowed to go stay in the Plattsburgh area. And eventually they changed that method, and we could go anywhere in Clinton County. And later on in 75, maybe 80, they opened it up to statewide.
That's probably prevented a lot of large dairies processing plants from taking over. It was the districting of milk areas where you had to be from that area and get a license to operate that.
Yeah, you had to get a license.
So with the typical, you know, when there were so many dairies in Clinton County, what would the typical driver picking up milk, what was he driving, and was he pumping it into a bulk tank?
No. They had milk cans, and I've seen times in the wintertime where it would be so much snow that we'd have to hitch the horses up and go out and pick up the cans with a team of horses and bring it back to manufacture it into bottled milk. And also, there was a time when milk, you had to go and buy it only when, you only could get so much at a time. So sometimes we'd go some different places and find milk and pay them a little extra so we could get the milk we needed. And then in 1942-43, gas ration came out, and they said that you're not going to get enough gas. So my uncle went with Bill Finney, and he went to New York City and bought a milk wagon. And they came back with a milk wagon, bought a pair of horses off in Neverts and Shazy and a pair of grays, and we started delivering milk with a pair of horses. Then they said that was unfair competition. Mm-hmm. So then we got all the kind of gas we wanted. But a little story behind that, you can cut this off if you want, is my uncle would go down through, and there's a lady down the road with the horses, and her name was Maud. And the horse's name was Maud. And he'd say, "Get up, Maud, get up." And finally, her husband came out and said, "What are you doing calling my wife in early in the morning at 4 o'clock?
It's the trouble of having a horse named Maud and a customer named Maud at the same time. So we're talking gas rations in the 1940s, yeah. and looking for a way to make a dollar and be a little best, more efficient than competitors. So you have all these dairies. Why do you think they slowly dropped off? And it really came down to, in the 1960s, there were three processing plants in the immediate area, maybe four or five if you count some of the outlying areas. Then it came down into the 1970s down to two. Why did these processing plants slowly dwindle away?
Because they weren't large enough to manufacture amount of milk you needed to be profitable. And there was a plant in the city of Plattsburgh called Tri-Gable, and they had Golden Guernsey milk, and they went out in 1948, maybe a little bit later, and I do have a bottle of theirs, but they originated in Chazy, and the family's name was Dickerson.
This Tri-Gables farm, I think when you go down to Dupree's Feed, is that the farm where Bill and Gene Arthur live? The
I
place
don't
right on the
Gene and Bill Arthur, but it's right across the road.
Okay, right where Bill and Gene Arthur live, that's where a processing plant would be, Tri-Gables. And when do you think they stopped processing milk in that location?
In Chazy?
Yeah.
I do not know.
So they converted and they went to Plattsburgh. So it's
on Margaret Street. Their plant was on Margaret Street, right across from L&M, I believe it's liquor store now. And then Curtis Eels went in there after they went out of business and sold Nash Ramblers.
Okay, interesting. So we're down to finding out why there's so few dairies left in the 1970s and 80s, and really came down to, I guess, the three dairies, Plattsburgh Dairy, Bayview Dairy, and Rosebud Creamery. But I guess we can get to the bottles, some of the bottles later, but you... I remember growing up and you would say that we're going to be buying out a dairy. And I remember some of the dairies that we bought out. And I know my grandfather, your father, would send you up to basically convert the business. And the last dairy that, one of the last dairies was Donnelly's Dairy, Crystal Springs Dairy. But I remember the story you told me about Bert Muzzin's. Bert Muzzin processed milk in Rouse's Point, correct?
Yes, he does, and I have one of his bottles. And we had to go, he wanted me to go with him, and he had this Dodge van. And I've seen one morning it was 40 below there. And he'd say, we got to keep the milk from freezing. So he'd put a milk can of hot water, in the truck, and then you couldn't see out the windows. It would steam the windows up so that it was almost impossible to see. But then that when we'd almost get done, we had to stop at this bar and have one beer. And then that was the end of the day.
Well, I don't know if that would work today, stopping for a beer by the end of the day. I think that would cause some controversy. But Bert Muzzin, when Pop Brandell, Bayview Dairy, bought out Bert, it was, what year do you think, roughly what year was that?
I can't remember exactly the year. I'd have to go back and look.
Would you say 1955?
Yes, it probably was.
Okay, in the mid-50s. So you had Bert Muzzin and Rouse's Point. And we'll take a look at some of these bottles in a moment after we get done talking, because there are several bottles here that represent the dairy business, the processing plants throughout Clinton County. But one that's close to northeastern Clinton that's now operating as a three-hole golf course would be Sunny Hill Dairy and the Robinsons, correct?
Correct.
So Tom Robinson operated Sunny Hill Dairy. And can you tell me anything you remember about
Sunny? Well, we purchased that dairy, and Tom wanted to get out of the business, so we purchased them, and it worked out very well for us. And he had Ashier cattle at the time.
So he has some Ashier cattle. And, you know, I think of Ashier cattle, and I think of the Guernsey. And one thing I think is important to mention and how things have changed over the year, the motto for Bayview Dairy for years was creamy, rich milk.
Well, yes. We at one point, we was another dairy in Plattsburgh. It had the Golden Guernsey label. And the farmers came to us and wanted us to take it over, in which we did, and that was released. It had to be 5% milk, and the cream top was unbelievable. In the wintertime, if it got left out, it popped the cap up 2 or 3 inches.
Well, I think for our viewers to understand that, today all milk today is homogenized. That means all the particles, the cream and milk, are mixed up evenly. So there's no chance at all for the cream to rise to the top. But in through the 60s, milk was unhomogenized, right? And then the cream would rise
before
the 60s. And so oftentimes if the milk was left out and it was getting cold, the cream would rise to the top.
And a lot of people bought the Guernsey milk, because they would take the top off and use it for cream for their coffee.
And today people aren't looking for creamy rich milk or golden Guernsey milk. They're looking for no fat milk or 1% milk. That's the dietary needs of today's population, I guess. But there was nothing like a good bottle of golden Guernsey back in the days.
We had to buy, we used to have to buy cream from Irona Creamery, especially around Christmas time and New Year's, and Champlain was big on cream, because the French people in Champlain, there were a big celebration of New Year's. So we would have to buy extra cream, because we didn't have, back then everybody, we didn't have low-fat milk back then. So cream was a big factor around the holidays for cooking too.
So I guess in my days in the milk business in the 80s, we were trying to get rid of cream. So if you go back 30, 40, and many years, cream was at a premium. You needed cream. So, you know, I think the dairies, the processing plants today, so a few of them, I guess it could be also similar to the family farm. And I guess when I was growing up, we're talking the 60s and the 70s, to understand that there were many, many local farms with milking even 30 or 40 cows, right?
That's correct.
So, and how many cows would you say like a dairy farm would have now?
Well, most of them are, there's still some small ones around, but I'd say the most of them are milking anywhere from 100 to 3,000.
So that you can see these, the North Country's landscape is littered with old farms that now have been converted to hobby farms or just not being used. Maybe they're doing hay or something like that, but there's not the milking that there used to be. Oh, and then some other things I wanted to bring up is we have some, if I can get a picture here. For example, there is the Bayview Dairy, the first farm. This is when, if you correct me if I'm wrong, but the family was farming and processing milk at the same time. Would that picture look correct?
Yes, it is. But behind here, onto the left of the barn, was the milk plant.
Okay, let me.
Now there was no pasteurization back then. Was that you had to heat it up and 168 degrees, and then you had to let it cool for 30 minutes. So our vats are around 800 quarts, so it depends how many vats we'd run, but it took a lot of time until we got the process of being short time pasteurization.
When you say short time, I guess my experience is when I was working at the dairy and helping out and doing a lot of the pasteurization, it was that immediate pasteurization where the milk would go through the disc, heat up quickly to the 160 or whatever degrees, and then the chill it right back down within 15 or 20 seconds, the whole process was over. Does that sound reasonable? So when you say short time, so back then when we were talking in the 1920s and 30s when pasteurization was first coming out, am I right about that time frame? That the pasteurization would take place, but then the milk would have a 30-minute cooling time.
Yeah, yes, it took 30 minutes.
Okay. So here's this farm was located, or in, is still located on Cumberland Head. The barn and the house are gone now. The house actually burned 3 years ago, and the first entrance of Champlain Park is where the farmhouse was. And I would be fair to say that the farm, before it was just a processing plant, Bayview Dairy, the farmland was basically Champlain Park?
Before, yes, but before my grandfather bought it in the 20s, that farm was tiled, and it was belonged to the Barber family. Apparently, it had a lot of money. And they took, and all they had is tiles, what they call clay tiles. And that whole farm was tiled back then, and that was very unusual.
And I think for our viewer to understand that, you can go throughout the North Country and see, if you see that large tubing now, it's done with almost like a PVC rolled plastic.
But it was all dug by hand.
And so we're talking tiling a farm, putting the tile down, putting the tubes down in the ground, so for better irrigation, for better drainage. So this farm was tiled. So that's the beginnings of Bayview Dairy. And so we have another picture here. And this gentleman right here is your dad, my grandfather, Charlie Brandell. And it looks like he's got a 1935 International truck. And this truck was probably, a couple other things are interesting on here. Bayview Dairy, grade A milk, maybe you can comment about that. Pasteurized milk and cream. And the phone number, a real complicated phone number for the day, was 7F3. So what do you remember about this truck? This was the year you were born, 1935. Do you remember anything about this photo being told to you or understanding?
I don't know much about the truck, no.
No. But when we talk about Starting out with Bayview Dairy, how many trucks do you think Charlie Brandell started out with?
We had two. One, my uncle Larry Parker had one, my father had one, and they were pickups. My uncle liked Dodge, my father wanted a Chevrolet. So they'd have these tops made to keep the sun off the milk, and then for the wintertime, they'd go up to Imperial Mill and buy these rolls, felt that they ran the processing of the wallpaper on, and they were very, very good. Milk wouldn't freeze.
So, for delivery, not for pickup.
Delivery, yes.
Yeah, so this is for delivery. This is actually processing the milk, taking it out to the customers. And here's another picture, and this picture is once again of Charles Brandell, 1945. I can see that etched at the top. So we're looking at this picture of Charles Brandell, 1945, in a 1940 International truck, and he's holding two milk bottles in his fingers. So we're basically progressing. We've talked about picking up the milk at the farm with the bulk delivery. Now processing the milk back at the plant. So Bayview Dairy processing milk, 1945, and then driving the milk to the customer. And at the time, you would deliver to businesses, to restaurants, to schools, and home delivery. And I think that would be a novel idea for some of our younger viewers. What was home delivery like from 45? And I think it ended in 72?
Probably. Well, home delivery, you know, there was a different type of customers than home delivery. Now, you had the people that worked at the mills, and you had the people in... The big thing was you either had to go back and collect the milk on, you had to collect their bills on either Friday or Saturday. So it took a long day on those days because you had to finish the route and then go back and collect. Most of those people would have their money in an envelope and they planned ahead of time what they had to pay for their milk. And
So when you say delivering milk, and we have a shot of a milk box right here, maybe Calvin can get that. The milk boxes came later, so when we're talking about delivering milk, how would you know? Would the family leave a note on what they want? Would it be pre-planned the day before? How would you know what the Johnson family wanted for milk? And I know the driver probably would have an idea of some habits that they would have, but say you're going to a family and you're going to drop the milk off, what do you know? How do you know what to deliver?
Well, you'd guess, and you'd get there, and then they'd leave a note, and they'd say, "Would you go leave a half pint of heavy cream or a quarter of chocolate?" And you didn't plan on that. So back to the truck you'd go, bring it back, and you'd be saying, "I wish they just would have the same order every time," but that didn't happen. And some of them, we used to put the milk in, they'd have it in their cellar window. So you'd have to lay on your stomach to put the milk on a shelf in the cellar. So that goes way back. And but most people were very good. But it was the biggest thing back then. For me, when I delivered house milk, was dogs. I've got bit, I don't know how many times, by a dog because there was no leash law back then. And it was the middle of the night when you're there, and the dog would grab a hold of your leg.
So middle of the night, dogs biting you, crawling on your stomach, seems like a pretty labor-intensive job. I guess to understand it would be to understand the amount of time. What time did the typical milkman start the day if you're going to go to the dairy, pick up your truck? And this is before refrigeration, so I guess you would have to load your truck. Refrigeration didn't really come in until late 60s, early 70s. So when you were working on the truck, what time did you get up? And what happened once you arrived at the dairy to start your day? What time was that?
Well, I was going to high school then. And I'd get up at 5 o'clock, and I'd deliver milk half pints to up on the air base. It was Champlain College at the time. And they were all half pints, and they'd always leave the caps on. So we used to take ice picks to pick the caps off the bottles, and that was a job when he got back to the bottle washer. But it would be about 5 o'clock, and we'd deliver milk to those places, institutions.
Okay. So now you're working full-time. You graduate from high school, and you're going... But you do, when you graduate from high school, you go to work at the dairy, and you have a run. What time... You know, because I want to get to the essence of loading your truck and delivering the milk and bringing it back. What time did you get up at home, and what time did you get back home?
Well, I used to get up at 1 o'clock and get the truck loaded, and then we'd leave. And I had keys to a lot of establishments, the wholesale places. And I'd be home by 10:30, 11 o'clock.
Now, home or home to the dairy?
Home to dairy, but then home at home.
Okay. Because the process, as I remember as a kid waking up, your last stop was generally the North Country Shopping Center and maybe down to Gus's, and that was either your first or your last, and then back to the dairy to unload the empties and to cash out, and if you had to, if you had refrigeration, we'd load up for the next day. Otherwise, you had to load that truck up again and again and again. And I know we had some drivers that would bring the truck back during the day, early mornings, because they couldn't fit everything in their truck, right?
That's correct.
Yeah. And the trucks that I remember, and I think many of the trucks throughout the dairy industry, were using these trucks called DIFCOs. Was that a particular model of truck that was unique to the dairy business?
They were made just for dairy and bread, and they were called a stand drive. They had one pedal, and a pedal with a clutch and a brake. So you could go along like pretty good pace, and just hit the brake and jump out, and the truck would stop. And you could get a lot done. But then we had these milk baskets we'd carry, and if you were strong enough to carry a 10-quart basket, you were maybe two of them, when we had on the base there, you were all man.
Well, I think we have one of those here. I don't know if Calvin got a shot of that, but there is a 10-quart milk case, and a lot of labor-intensive work back in this dairy business. So why don't we take a look at some of, well, you got something else you want to talk about?
Yes, when we had bottles, it was sometimes a problem, because people would put gasoline, kerosene in these bottles, and you had to be careful. Another thing I remember is the restaurants we'd go to, and the milk bottles were used a lot for coffee. Now, so they put the hot coffee in the milk bottle. What do you think they used so the milk bottle wouldn't break? They'd put a knife in there, mm-hmm. and the knife would somehow create so it wouldn't crack that bottle.
Counter some of the temperature change or something like that. So I guess many people mistook the milk bottle as something that they could use for their own personal use, and when they're supposed to be returning those bottles. So I'm sure you had to replenish the bottles. Your father had to replenish the bottles frequently.
We had what they call store bottles. And whoever got the store first, bottles were expensive, and they would take probably some of your bottles, because you wouldn't know they were universal, and said 5 cents on them. So my father said, we'll take care of that. We'll turn it and we'll go to 53-millimeter bottles, which had a different cap. So nobody else had them, so we got our own bottles back.
Always, we're fighting over bottles, and probably today, I say the same thing today, you can see milk cases around the North Country, those plastic milk cases, people like to use them in the back of motorcycles, and those are good little storage bins that technically you're breaking the law, because you're supposed to be returning those. They have a deposit on them, and somebody paid for that, and it has to go back to the dairy it came from. So I know you have a lot of bottles here. Can you show us maybe something that's really, really interesting? Or
well, I find this bottle here. I just got not too long ago. It's a White Face Dairy. And what I've been told, I'm not a skier, and it's got the runs on the bottle of the old runs when they had the runs at White Face Mountain. So I'm so really happy to have this bottle, and it's was all Sable Dairy who put it out, and they call it White Face Dairy. And then I have another bottle. Where's that little cream bottle, Tom?
Little cream bottle.
No, it was.
Okay, we're back, and we're looking at a picture of this would be Plattsburgh Dairy, and I'm going to guess this is in the 1940s, maybe a little earlier. And Plattsburgh Dairy, the building, believe it or not, is still on Saley Avenue. You have to drive carefully. If you drive carefully, you can peek between some of the driveways or in the driveways a few places, and I think it might be 74. You can see the remnants of the buildings back there. So there was a processing plant back there. And this picture is of the fleet of Plattsburgh Dairy back in the day. And I understand from my dad that this is Emmett Roach, who is the owner, who's standing next to the vehicle. And what can you tell me about the life of somebody, you know, the Plattsburgh Dairy, of the Roaches, and eventually it became the Pearls, correct?
Well, yes. They had they were probably the largest dairy in Clinton County at the time. And they had the 29th Infantry business and the maneuvers, and they get that. And eventually they bought a farm on 22 South, and they kept cows there for a while. And then eventually they went into an ice cream shop on Route 9 South.
Was that the Altamont?
No. It was their own. I can't remember the exact name of it, but it was... on Route 9 South, right by Cliff Haven.
Okay. Now, do you remember when they basically shut down, or did
1960.
They? 1960. 1960 was the end of.
My dad bought them out.
So then, we're talking from 1960 until 1994. There were just two dairies left in the North Country, right?
I believe so.
Bayview and Rosebud. And can you tell me where Rosebud Creamery was located?
Well, they first were located up on Hammond Lane. And there was a Clarence Gale and Ted Paris were involved in that. And eventually Ted Paris purchased it from the Clarence, and then he ran it prior to that.
Okay, after that was Ted Paris, and he had some, Reggie Paris, his brother, also assisted him.
He ran the place in Atlantic.
So we had Rosebud Creamery, main location, processing milk in Plattsburgh. And when they, basically where the Texas Roadhouse is now, it was a milk processing plant. So they went out of business in 94, and Bayview out in 90. November of 90, and now milk comes from very, very far away, processed in Binghamton, processed in Syracuse, processed in Boston. So our milk comes from very far away. Some of the milk does come from our local farms, but going backwards now, looking at some of these old milk bottles, if I mentioned Martin Farms to you, what comes to mind?
Martin Farms was on Boynton Avenue, and there's a big white house there, and it's close to... George Hubble's swimming place. And if you look way back in there, you probably see part of the old dairy. And they were in there until probably the 40s. And then we got, it was probably one of the last ones to go out, was Clearview Dairy.
Well, you got a Clearview Dairy bottle here.
And that was on Route 22. And I go by there now, and I see that the old milk plant is still there, but it's not very, very big. You'd have to look twice. And they sold out to Plattsburgh Dairy.
So Clearview Dairy, can you tell me again on 22 where that is?
Well, it'd be past the old Plattsburgh Dairy Farm on the left. Okay. His name was Trombley, who owned it.
Okay, so we got Clearview Dairy with a... another telephone number of 17F14. And oh, here's a dairy from Peru, New York. W.O. Clark in the bottle, equipped to guard your health. It must be how the benefits of milk. So do you remember anything about the W?
I don't remember too much about him, but I do know Datus Clark was involved with that in his family.
He ran the Clinton County Board of Elections, Datus Clark, for a long time.
Yes.
So that's part of his family heritage. So that's the W.O. Clark dairy in Peru, New York. Here's a one people should probably recognize the name, Atwood Orchards, Plattsburgh, New York. What can you tell me about Atwood Orchards?
That was on Route 9 where they have the they have an orchard, and they had last year cattle there. And if you notice in a lot of these bottles, that they don't have an H on the end of the of Plattsburgh, so that you then you know they're an older bottle, okay?
So Atwood Dairies, Plattsburgh, New York. I think it'd be good to get a. Okay, this bottle here, filled with some small little styrofoam, it says Leo Gay and Grade A Raw. So that's got to be an old bottle.
1928. That's the dairy that my grandfather purchased.
Okay. So Larry Parker, Wesley Larry Parker, purchased Leo Gay's farm. And where was Leo Gay's, where was he?
Moffett Road.
Up on the Moffett Road, okay. Right. And what else we got here? Let me grab, let me get that Sunny Hill Dairy, if I can, here it is. So close to, on Route 11, just past the intersection of 276, if you're headed towards Rouse's Point, is the still today, I believe the sign is out there still, Sunny Hill Farm, and it was Sunny Hill Dairy, and it says for service, call 297-9050, your local dairy man. And that bottle, would you say, Dad, that bottle is probably from the 60s, 50s?
Yeah, yes, it's not an old one.
Okay.
Now, if you want to look at this right here, see what it says on that.
Okay. Looking at Uplands Meadows Incorporated, successor to Merrill's Dairy, Keysville, New York. And there's a collar on it. Looks like an aluminum collar. It says Upland Meadowlands Incorporated, 10-cent deposit. What can you tell me about Upland Meadows?
Well, they didn't go to the store bottle, but they put a tag on their regular bottles. Instead of taking 5 cents, they charged 10. And
just another effort
were,
to try to.
They were very small.
Just another effort to keep track of your inventory, would you say?
They didn't lose many bottles because they got 10 cents.
Okay. Here's one that I think you're pretty proud of. I think many of our viewers would want to take a look at this bottle. It says 1 quart liquid. Heart's Delight Farm, Chazy, New York. And I think anybody who's from the Chazy area knows that William H. Minor, one of his passions was farming, hobbies too, and Heart's Delight was his farm. And what can you tell me about this bottle, and do you remember where you got it and things of that nature?
I bought this up near Malone, and I was told, well, this is 10 years ago, that they didn't have a quart bottle, they had a half pint. But the miners, they did have a milk plant there. And when I was a young boy, we used to go up there and buy our meat there. They had a slaughterhouse too.
Okay, so Heart's Delight looks like a very valuable bottle and perhaps even more valuable to the people at Miners Institute. So if we move along here, I don't know, this bottle is one of the more unique ones you have here. This is Thatcher Manufacturing Company, calendar for 1941. And it says on the side, dependable MTC every day of the year. So, and this has still got, this has got a cap on it too. So what do you know about the Thatcher Dairy?
Well, Thatcher was the first, one of the first people that manufactured a dairy bottle. And they were located in Potsdam, New York. Now this bottle here would be the bottle that the salesman would come around with and give you for Christmas or whenever he came in. And I just thought it was quite neat.
This is a novelty bottle then. This is more the salesman comes around and give you this bottle for a calendar. That is very interesting. And let's look at an old Bayview Dairy bottle. I can tell you told me that look for, if it has no H, it's got to be old. So this one, Bayview Dairy, without looking at it too closely, Dad, what would you say that, when was this bottle? Was this from the 40s?
Well, it was one of the earlier bottles because it's 48 milligram at the top of the bottle here.
When you say 48 milligram,
on the side of the top because of the cap.
Now, I want to go back to that for a moment. When you talked about kind of a competitive advantage some people would have to kind of keep track of their inventory of bottles, you keep changing the size so you couldn't mix
them. Well, they kept one size, and the other dairies all kept the regular size bottle.
Okay. And what do you got here? Okay. Asgard Dairy. It says Rockwell Kent, Ossable Forks, the renowned painter, artist, Rockwell Kent. What was his involvement with Asgard Dairy?
He ran a dairy there, and he had a problem with it because of his political relationships, and he had a hard time selling milk.
So people saw him as a lefty liberal, and then nobody wanted to buy milk from him?
They called him, but back then it was probably something else.
Communist Red?
I don't want to say that.
Okay. So I had a little history lesson there. Probably people recognized that Rockwell Kent, typically people of the time who were artists, were a little more on the liberal side, or perhaps even more on the socialist or communist side. And that was obviously well known and probably discouraged people from buying milk from the Asgard Dairy. There's a bottle here that I want you to talk about. It says the State University of New York Agricultural and Technical Institute. Are you telling me that the SUNY campuses at the time were in the milk business, and are they still? Or?
Yes, they were in the process of milk because they had a school there for college kids to go there and to take this course in milk processing and so forth, and they did process their own milk there. That's not a way old bottle, but it's probably the early 70s.
Okay, so even to the early 70s, State University of New York was looking into the milk business. We already talked to Clearview. Signer's Dairy, this is a pint, correct?
Half pint.
This is a half pint. So this would be different than what we have today at schools. When you look at the half pint of milk students drink from, they would be drinking from a glass. This is interesting. In the back of this, it says, listen, pal, I hope they use Signer's Dairy milk where you're taking me. And it has a picture of a child being held up in the air by the stork. So Signer's Dairy in Keysville, any particular recollection of Signer's Dairy?
Yes, we purchased those from George Signer, and he was quite aggressive about his bottles with he had nursery rhymes on like we did at Bayview, and I guess that's about all I can say.
What are these little, tiny little bottles you have here? You got one that says Sunny Hill, Champlain, New York, and it's got the phone number, and you've got one that says Bayview Dairy, and another one, People's Dairy. I remember People's Dairy, Lake Placid. Maybe you can talk a little bit about what were these used for?
They were creamers that we would give out, and they'd come 144 in a box. And you would give them out to restaurants to put the cream in for the coffee. And you'd probably lose everyone you put out because people would take them for souvenirs and so forth. But it was good advertisement.
So not so much used for the processing of milk, but more for the advertisement to get your name out there. So I've gone through quite an extensive collection of bottles here. Wallace Hill Dairy, Dad. Do you know where we have that one?
Wallace Hill was located on Wallace Hill, and his name was Gruby. It ran the plant, ran the business. He owned the business, and he had a brother who had a place up the road from there. His name was Paul. I do not have a bottle of Paul's, but Gruby's were one of the later ones to go out of business.
So Wallace Hill was it two Gruby brothers and then split?
Originally it was one brother mm-hmm. up the road, and this one here was the other brother.
Okay. I guess we're kind of getting down to the end of most of the local bottles. Okay, let's get one here of Rosebud Creamery. This is an older Rosebud Creamery. I think many of the viewers would probably recognize Rosebud if they remember, late 80s, early 90s, because they were the last dairy to stand in Clinton County. And since then, the plant's been torn down, and there's no remnants of the building. There's no remnants of the Bayview Dairy building. That's been torn down. So I guess you'd have to do a little archaeological dig to find some evidence about the dairies in Plattsburgh, in particular Rosebud in Bayview. So I think We've got a few other things. We've got the milk bottles. We've got the home delivery boxes, and maybe we can kind of wrap up a little bit talking about home delivery boxes. And I know we have one at the house, but it's not used for milk. But did Bayview and Rosebud and all the dairies provide these? And when did the home delivery milk box come into existence, and when did it go out of existence?
I'd say early 50s.
So 1950s, the dairies started dropping these at homes. And what did that allow you to do?
Well, it allowed us to put milk in when the sun wouldn't get to it. And the winter time, it wouldn't freeze. But I had one customer that was probably smarter than all of them. She used to use an oatmeal box, and it fit one quart would fit right in there so nice. You put the oatmeal cover back on, and it was the bottle never froze.
Perfect insulation, the oatmeal box.
And that milk can you're looking at was a later milk can.
Right.
The older milk cans had a different type of handle.
Okay, and I brought that one out basically as a measuring stick. When even to the last day of processing, and I don't know if it's done like this today, that the volume of milk put out, the standard measure is how many quarts did you put out for the day, right? And in this particular, we used, even to the end, we used a 40-quart can to help mix the milk, to make the appropriate level of 1%, to make the appropriate level of cream into the 2%. It was all done by 40-quart cans, correct? And I guess that's it, and we really appreciate... Okay, I think we're about ready to wrap up here, but interesting, Calvin took a shot of this card that was issued to all the customers of Bayview Dairy that went out in must have been November or December of 1972. It says, "Dear customer, effective January 1st, 1973, our milk prices will go up. Just want to focus on one of the prices. A homogenized half gallon of milk was 61 cents. And we were just talking off air, the price of a half gallon is probably somewhere in the neighborhood of $1.50, $60, or $70. It seems like the price has gone up a lot, but if you factored in inflation, I don't think you've seen the price go up. And as Calvin was saying earlier, much of the price is not absorbed by the farmer. It's taken by the middleman. But interesting to note this date, you know, we're talking in the 70s, early 70s, we're talking about the gas crisis and the price of milk probably going up. And I know that was the end of home delivery, was basically in 1972. And so the milk business has changed a lot over the years, whether the dairies have changed from 50 dairies in Clinton County or more down to no dairies, all the milk coming processed out of town, to the family farm really being a thing of the past, and it's a business farm with hundreds of cows, if not up to 1,000. But it's important for people to know that it was a thriving industry in Clinton County, that a lot of hard work and effort was put into providing a fresh product every day so people could start their day with a glass of milk or a cup of coffee with cream in it. So I want to thank you, Dad, for doing this today. I know it was a great effort by Calvin to get you to do this over the years, I guess. But it's been very informative, and I hope some of our younger viewers will get something out of it. Thank you very much.